Those of you that have been watching long enough might remember this old Landcool K7 case. This used to be my main rig years and years ago, and then after I upgraded to the Corsair case, this got moved down to my workshop, and then after a while it got disassembled again and put back in the box when I sold it to my boss to build an office computer, and I moved to a smaller micro ATX case down here. Well, this has been sitting on the shelf for quite some time now. You can see all the dust collected on the box. And I finally got the rest of the hardware to put this system together, so let's build something out of this thing, shall we? I still get a kick out of some of the things that are written on this box. Optimized LAN party structure. What are you comparing it to? This is not really meant to be transported all over the place, by any means. Strength 40% plus tougher. Maybe if you compare it to a really low-end case. I mean, it's not bad, but there's certainly some fragile parts on it. Cable management. Not really. Anti-vibration design. I'll give them that. The hard drives are mounted in rubber grommets. Liquid cooling system ready. Back then, maybe. And quad cord and SLI ready. That's an interesting typo. I've always wanted a quad cord computer. Like, I don't have enough power hunger crap already. The motherboard I'll be using for this build is an Asus B85M-E corporate stable model. This is actually geared towards business use with the B85 chipset. It's not anything super powerful, but it's more than adequate for the job and a very nice upgrade from the old Athlon X2 250 that's currently being used. The main drive used in this system is a Samsung SM863 Enterprise SSD. This is designed for more write intensive use and systems like database servers and things. I think it'd be a really nice drive for the job based on what this system's going to be used for. I didn't want to sacrifice speed or reliability. I also have a second drive that is used to perform automatic nightly backups. The secondary drive, which is just a mechanical drive used to perform the automatic backups every night, is a 500GB Western Digital RE series, also Enterprise class, and it has 64 megs of cache. For the memory, I have an 8GB kit of Crucial Ballistics Sport DDR3 1600 running at Cas 9. And for the CPU, a Pentium G3258. This is not the slowest chip on the Socket 1150 platform, but it's definitely not the fastest either. I just wanted something that was a good compromise between power usage, performance, and cost, and I think this one fit the bill perfectly. This system has to run 24/7, so I didn't want to go too crazy with the hardware on it, especially for what it's being used for, mainly just doing office work. A couple more pieces of hardware. This is just a, I think, $14 or $15 Asus DVD burner. I had a heck of a time getting that thing out of its bubble wrap package. It was in there so tight I don't know how it didn't break something. And over here is just a cheap Rosewill SSD mounting bracket. Since I'm using an older case that does not accommodate 2.5-inch SSDs natively. The power supply that I'm using for this system is rather overkill for what it is, but I wanted something with good efficiency and a good reliability. This is an EVGA Supernova 550G2, the first time I've actually used an EVGA power supply. I can't remember off the top of my head who the actual OEM of this is, but I know it got some good ratings on websites like Johnny Guru, who takes apart power supplies and does a lot of testing on them. This actually got a perfect 10 rating from them, and supposedly has really good quality parts inside. And I can definitely tell you that this thing is very heavy, so I'm anxious to see what this has to offer once I get it out of the box. Man, I love me some shiny brand new motherboards, even if they're just simple ones like this. This doesn't have any fancy heat sinks or all kinds of accessories or anything. In fact, this one only came with two SATA cables, a manual, a CD, and an I.O. shield. But it does have all solid capacitors, four RAM slots, a PCI Express 16, and I think the other bottom slot is X16 size, but only X8 electrically. I'd have to look at the manual again. I know there's fewer pins in it. On the back, it has two USB 3.0, HDMI, DVI, VGA, and even the classic PS2 ports, which I still use quite a bit. It seems like the writing on this CPU is really big compared to what I'm used to seeing on Intel chips. Usually they're really small writing and hard to read, and this one's also made in Vietnam. That's kind of interesting. I still miss the days when Intel had a full-size metal plate behind the CPU that actually went all the way to the mounting holes for the cooler, and the cooler used screws with springs on them. It was just seemed like it was a lot better mounting system. And this little metal plate doesn't seem to help very much for preventing board flex. And when mounting these pushpin coolers, I don't care for the way it feels, but they seem to work and they don't have as many problems as you would think, so whatever, I guess. Well, aside from all the dust on this, it felt a lot like when I unboxed it for the first time all those years ago. So it's kind of neat to be able to build another system with this after so long. And I also totally forgot that there was an optical drive already installed in here, which I don't think is very old. So that was a nice little bonus. I'll be saving that for my next build. And I'll put the new one back in this case. Ah, nostalgia. All the original parts, all the screws and mounting hardware were still in the box in this case. And I was disappointed to see that the rear fan is missing though, so I'm going to have to find one to put in there. And I forgot about the drive cage in here. One thing that always bugged me about this case was that this drive cage is kind of backwards. The connectors face the opposite direction, so you have to take the other side panel off the case to remove the drives, rather than being able to install and remove them from this side of the case. That was always kind of cumbersome. And I think you can turn this cage 90 degrees, but not 180 degrees. So I'm just going to have to leave it like it is. The optical drive bay has those quick release tabs, but for some reason you still have to use screws in it for the drive to be secure. So that was kind of pointless. And the cable management in here is, you can definitely tell it's an older case. It's got a top power supply mount and kind of primitive cable management. Sometimes I kind of miss the removable motherboard tray that this case had. And another thing that I thought was kind of interesting was the I/O shield for this motherboard. Instead of the traditional metal tabs that stick out, it has this kind of squishy foam pad. But I guess in a way that's kind of nice, because I can't tell you how many times I've built a computer in the past and get it all together and go to plug something in and find out that that stupid metal tab is down inside the USB port or something, and oh, that makes me mad. And then you gotta take everything all back apart just to take that stupid I/O shield back out. But yeah, this is kind of an interesting approach to that problem. One nice thing about this removable motherboard tray is that it's really easy to hook up the front panel. I've even scrounged up one of those cheesy little beeper speakers for the BIOS diagnostics and the fan alarms and such, because I like having those in there. But I noticed this motherboard has just about every port except for 1394. I mean, there's even a COM port over here, there's a parallel port over here, but no 1394, so poor Mr. 1394 port is so lonely and has nowhere to go. No love for 1394, but I can't say that I've ever used it either, so that's probably why they've taken it off of a lot of modern boards. It's just kind of phased out in favor of USB 3.0 and 3.1. But anyway, I think I'm about ready to put this into the case and get these drives installed. For an enterprise-grade SSD, this thing sure is light. It weighs pretty much nothing. I think it's made out of plastic. That mechanical drive, on the other hand, is a brick. Gotta love this SSD mount. It's entirely made out of plastic. It comes with four screws, or eight screws actually, of which are certainly steel or maybe zinc with a bit of powder coating. But it also comes with this big sticker that says, California Proposition 65 Warning. Products with exposed solder may contain lead, a chemical known to the state of California to cause birth defects and other reproductive harm. Really? It's plastic. So I'm going to make a proposition, and I'll call it Proposition 69, and say that, warning, this piece of paper may contain bullshit. For the rear fan, I dug out this Noctua NF-S12 that's been laying around. This particular model of Noctua is not very well suited for anything restrictive, such as radiators or filters, but it works really well in the back of a case like this, where there's really no restriction to the airflow. It has these really thin blades, so it doesn't have a lot of static pressure. If you do have something restrictive like a filter or a radiator or one of those really fine perforated fan grills in your case, something with bigger blades like this Noctua NF-P12 would be a better idea. These have a lot higher static pressure than the S12 does. And I know they've got some models that are newer than this and even further improved, but the P12 is still one of my favorite fans to work with. There's a bit of room left over in the case still. I had to add this cheesy green SATA cable because the motherboard only came with two cables, both of which are being used on hard drives. And of course this green cable is just a little bit too short to be routed through the cable management slots, and it's going to sit there in the way. But it's kind of good that there's extra room inside this case, because I'm about to crap it all up with a big old power supply in a second here. More shiny new parts. Got a cable pouch, lots of cables. I think this is actually a modular power supply, which is going to be nice for this older case where there's not a lot of room. And this is packed a lot like the Corsair power supply that I've had in my main rig for so many years now. I guess these higher end power supplies are packaged, you know, in a similar way. Lots of different cables here, and they're all covered in that fancy braided material. Man, that's where a lot of the weight is in the box, but let me get the power supply itself out of here and we'll take a closer look at that. Check this out, it even has a pouch to hold the power supply itself. Nice. They definitely give you a good assortment of cables with this power supply. There's three SATA cables, which each hold three devices on them. They give you a 4-pin Molex adapter to adapt over to the smaller style connector. I still call that a floppy drive connector, but most people nowadays are using that for something else, like a card reader or a multimedia panel or something. There's two cables that are for PCI Express, and they can accommodate either 6 or 8-pin plugs on each cable. They have that kind of two-piece split design. And then there's another cable here that supports, it looks like, three of those standard 4-pin Molex devices. And then they give you a few Velcro cable ties, a cable storage pouch, and the standard motherboard and AC cables, and some screws and owner's manual. I still can't believe they even give you a pouch for the power supply itself. That's kind of unusual. I forgot to mention this little jumper connector that came with the power supply. I think it's just used to turn the power supply on manually for testing purposes when you don't have a motherboard. It's just got two pins in it, and I'm assuming that they go to the power on and ground wires, but I think it's the first time I've ever seen one of those included with the power supply. As for the power supply itself, it's definitely a monster. It's got quite a bit of weight to it. It has this weird texture paint stuff on it. And I think it's the first time I've seen the fan that's held in by something that's not a Phillips head screw. These are look like an Allen head screw, or hex head, whichever you want to call it. And I can see the capacitors in the output section through the fan grill a little bit, and just by the appearance that they have, I can tell that they're made by United Chemicon. There's all sorts of goodies in there. I wish I could take it apart and have a look inside, but I don't want to void the warranty. There are pictures of the inside of these online, though. It's got the modular hookups for everything, and this switch here I think is to control the fan, have it either run all the time or be thermally controlled. I'm just going to have it on all the time because I'm more concerned about reliability than I am silence. Here's all the ratings. Obviously most of the power is on the 12 volt rail, about 45 amps. 550 watts total at 50 degrees Celsius and 80 plus gold rating. This is probably the most efficient power supply that I've ever bought. I think all the ones I've used prior to this were just bronze rated. And this is definitely more power than the system will ever need, but I wanted lots of headroom and extra reliability. Considering the limited amount of cable management that this case has, I don't think it turned out all that bad. Most of the power supply cables are secured up in the top of the case by that cable clamp. Some of it is on top of the optical drive, and a few things are ran behind the motherboard tray and held in by those cable management clamps back there. But I wish I could have done a little bit more with the wiring towards the bottom, but I didn't want to tie those together and risk putting any excess strain on the SATA connectors, because they're pretty fragile. But I think everything's connected now, so I can finally put the right hand side panel on now that I don't need to get to the back of the hard drives, and I can hook this up and test it. Unfortunately, I completely lost track of time, and it is 10 o'clock at night. I'm supposed to be in bed. I gotta work in the morning, so I'm not gonna be able to see if this thing works until tomorrow, and that bums me out. But lucky for you guys, you're not going to have to wait, because I'm just going to edit this video. Ah, finally, 24 hours later, I finally get to test this thing. You know how hard it is to wait a whole day after you've assembled something to even try turning it on? But anyway, let's see what this thing does. Now, I won't forget that switch this time. I do that a lot. Oh, there's a standby LED. Power LED, hard drive LED. Looks like everything's working in the front panel. And there's the diagnostic beep. That was too easy. New CPU installed. Please enter setup to configure your system. Sweet. I love these modern BIOSes, as long as they're arranged in a nice way. Sometimes these menus get confusing on some boards, but still, when they're done right, they're nice. But let me go through here and make sure everything is tweaked up. Okay, that was odd. I was checking the boot order to boot from the CD, USB stick, and when I rebooted, it said CPU change had been detected. Blah blah blah, and I go back into the BIOS, and now it looks like it has changed the RAM on its own, and it's now running at 1400 megahertz. It detects the RAM as 1600 megahertz, which is what it's rated for, but it used to say 1333 up here, I think. So it's adjusted something on its own, apparently. But anyway, let's go right into the boot menu here and boot from the USB so I can install Windows. Hopefully it's not gonna give me messages like that every time I turn it on, but it shouldn't. That was just odd, because I didn't change any settings in the BIOS for the clock speed or anything. It just kinda did it on its own. Alright. Well, this shouldn't take too long. That's the nice thing about USB. Even though this computer has a brand new optical drive, I still prefer to make a USB stick and install from there. It's just a lot more convenient, a lot quicker, and quieter. So I'll let this do what it needs to do and continue back in a minute here. Even though there's a few things I don't like about Windows 10, I can honestly say that after using it for a while, it's definitely a lot easier to deal with when it comes to device drivers, at least in my experience, and on the hardware I've used it on. I've probably spent over an hour now just installing drivers manually, one by one, and I've still got one unknown device here in the device manager that won't go away no matter what I do. I've installed every driver that was on the website for this board, and Windows, a couple times I tried telling it to search online automatically and it said it couldn't find anything. Now I've tried it again and now this dialog box has just been stuck here for probably 15 or 20 minutes, and I really need to get on with it so I can test this thing and you know, get it finished up. But the last few systems I've put Windows 10 on, there was a few times where there was unknown devices like this, but it was always able to find the driver when I would right-click on it and tell it to search online, even if it was some obscure device that I had never heard of. But oh, I miss Windows 7 in some ways, but when it comes to stuff like this and being clunky like this, it almost reminds me of trying to put XP on something that was too new for it. But what else? The activation. That was the first time I'd come across the activation period immediately being expired out of the box. And I had to manually install the network driver and get the computer some internet access, and then the activation completed no problem. But usually they give you, I think, 30 days to activate, so that was definitely odd. The system sure has a knack for making me sit here and wait when I'm pressed for time. I figured since Windows Update is not going anywhere, it just says checking for updates, like indefinitely, I decided I would go on and download the Intel Processor Diagnostic Tool and let that run for a while to check the CPU stability. And it starts downloading the .NET Framework client and stops with 2 megs left to go and just sits there forever. And I cancel it and it says, "Are you sure you want to cancel?" I hit yes, and now that's just sitting here forever and ever and ever. So I don't know what the deal is, but you know, really, this should have been done 2 hours ago. There's a clue right there. All those instances of SVC host, those are for the Windows Update, I think. And one of them is using 1.3 gigs of memory and 50% of the processor.
Holy crap. Well, let's hope the power doesn't go out, because I don't have a UPS plugged into this. Well, it's always nice to go through 200 and something updates and reboot and get stuck at a screen like this. I saw that it said, "Please wait while configuring updates," and then it said something about a failed logon. And then the screen went to this, and it's been sitting there ever since. However, there's still hard drive activity, so I'm going to give it some time and see if it restarts on its own. Ah, patience paid off. It restarted itself after a couple of minutes. And it's going to do it again. At least it's an SSD and it boots up really fast. And start again. How many updates can we configure? Ah, finally, desktop.
Well, to make a long story short, Windows 7 has been a nightmare on this system, and I actually told my boss about that, and he said, oh, we can use Windows 10 on that system. It's no big deal. So Windows 7's about to get nuked. And I couldn't be happier. I know Windows 10 isn't perfect, but we'll see firsthand just how much simpler it is, or if it's going to be any simpler. Hopefully it will be. One thing with Windows 10 that has a bit of trouble is this automatic updates during install. This thing can get stuck there forever, so I always skip that and do it later, because that has a similar problem to the updates on Windows 7. Not really sure why that is. Windows Update is just kind of hit and miss. But I'm looking forward to getting this upgrade out of the way so that I can finally get out of the driver hell that I've been stuck in and get on with the testing. Well, this is annoying. Everything's working great, except there's residue left over from the Asus automatic driver installers that were used on Windows 7, and also from Windows 7 itself, installing updates. It's left junk on both hard drives, just these odd folder names, and I don't know why it was putting things on the second hard drive. You know, it's not supposed to be using that for storage. But regardless, now that the activation is taken care of, I'm just going to format both drives and do a clean install of Windows 10 so that this will be absolutely pristine before I go any further with testing. Alright, here we are back at the fresh desktop after a clean install. Let's check on the device manager. So we have some unknown devices here. Wonder how many of them I can get installed automatically. I probably should have waited until the updates were complete, but whatever. Okay, downloading and installing. That's a good sign. That one's done. Let's take care of this one. Done. Now we have this unknown device that's been plaguing us on Windows 7. Let's see what this one is. Done. Some odd device called the AMD A00 interface. The thing I could never find a driver for on Windows 7, but there you go. Activation is also successful. I didn't have to do a doggone thing. Everything's up and running. Within less than 20 minutes, everything is complete. Now I can install some programs and do some real testing. And what do you know? The Windows Updater actually kind of works in Windows 10. Instead of sitting there and doing nothing for forever and ever. I mean, there are some things I still miss about Windows 7, especially with the interface, and I don't like a lot of the spyware-ish type crap that's on Windows 10, but I gotta say, it sure is easier to work with when it comes to installation and updates. You know, I had this whole OS installed and several programs in about maybe 20 minutes or less, so definitely a lot less stress for me when it comes to getting a computer set up. But I don't remember Windows 7 being that hard in the past. It's almost like the update system on Windows 7 has gotten broken in recent times. And I know that with newer hardware like this, there's going to be some driver difficulty, but I really don't remember Windows 7 being that hard to deal with. But I think over time, when Windows 10 matures a little bit more, it's going to get even better, at least I hope. This is the updated version 15.11 release, which that I used to do a clean install. And so far everything works pretty good on it. This is the same version I used to play the old Need for Speed High Stakes game on my workshop computer and everything else. And I haven't run into anything that hasn't worked on it yet, so I'm pretty happy with it, and hopefully Microsoft isn't going to take any majorly wrong turns and mess it up in the future. Let's see this thing choke on Cinebench. Run the CPU test. I can already tell my computer upstairs totally destroyed this thing, but this isn't going to be used for rendering movies or anything like that. Just throwing around spreadsheets and doing some web browsing and things like that. But I'm still curious how fast it's going to be in comparison. I think I'm going to pause the camera until this is done, because this is going to take a minute. Well, it's definitely slow, but it actually did beat out the smallest one in the chart here, which was a Core i5-3317U, but it ended up scoring 239 points. Pretty pathetic compared to what I'm used to seeing, but again, this is an office computer, not a rendering workstation. But speaking of CPU power, I'm curious how many watts this thing is using from the wall outlet. So I'm going to go hook up my power meter to this and check that. Check this out. The system is still busy doing some things in the background, and it still manages to stay under 30 watts most of the time. That's pretty impressive. Well, this is kind of odd. I don't think Memtest 86 is detecting the setup quite properly on this, because it's reading the RAM as DDR3 1862, which is basically 1866 at CAS 8, even though the RAM is only rated for 1600 megahertz at CAS 9, and I do not have XMP turned on. So I don't know what the BIOS is doing, you know, whether that set something funny or Memtest is just, you know, not detecting the settings, but I thought that was kind of weird. I'm going to let this go for several hours if I can and make sure it's stable, and I think I can finally go put it to use tomorrow. Well, I can't help myself. Let's watch some YouTube videos. Maybe see if it'll play this 4K video that somebody recorded using the same camera that I have. Let's run this full screen here. Put it at 4K and see if it chokes. No, it's working. Oh, there's not a lot of video in here. There's a lot of still. Yeah, it's stuttering a little bit. It might be alright after it catches up. Kind of funny, I'll be rendering a video of a 4K video in 4K on a very small monitor. Yeah, I think it's having a hard time keeping up though. Either that or it's just the downloading speed's not quite enough. I'm not really sure. Because unfortunately YouTube doesn't leave the progress bar on the screen when you hover the mouse over it like it used to. It'll still go away regardless. But I don't have an actual 4K monitor to look at stuff like this on yet. Ironic that I record in 4K and can't actually view it, but that day will come. Pretty soon 4K is going to be the next 1080p, and everybody's going to be like, oh, you don't have 8K yet! Ah!